Let's now look at two prototypical examples of applications of Markov chains. So what I've drawn here is something called the directed graph. And in a directed graph, we have nodes. In this case, there are three nodes or three possible outcomes. And what we're describing here with this graph are transitional probabilities between various outcomes for an economy. So you'll notice in a directed graph, there are arrows pointing sort of from one state or one outcome to another. So for instance, we have the outcome of our, economy is sort of experiencing normal growth, mild recession, or severe recession. Now between each of these outcomes, we have an arrow again directed towards another outcome, and attached to each of those arrows is a weight or is a probability measure. So for example, if I want to determine based on this analysis the probability that if our economy is in a normal growth state, it will maintain normal growth. That probability is quite high, right? 97.1%. On the other hand, the probability that we transition from a normal growth at any sort of given year to a mild recession is 0.029, and so forth. Now, there aren't arrows between each of the nodes, in which case there would be probably zero. So because a mild recession represents something of an intermediate outcome, right, there is no direct arrow between normal growth and severe recession or vice versa. So that probability is zero. First, we have to devolve into a mild recession before we hit a severe recession. By the way, these numbers are actually based on recent statistics related to the U.S. economy. So they weren't totally plucked out of thin air, in other words. Now, based on this directed graph, what I'd like to do is define my stochastic matrix P for this Markov chain. And then given some initial state of our economy, we can then make a prediction. We can, in other words, forecast about sort of our economic future. So here then we have the associated stochastic matrix, we'll call it P, that once again reflects the transitional probabilities as shown in our directed graph above. So for the numbers in column one, then we can think of interpreting them as transitional probabilities for our economy if we are currently in a natural growth state. So the probability, in other words, when we're in natural growth, if we look at the directed graph to maintain at natural growth is 0.971, and we see that number here. On the other hand, to transition probability from natural growth, say to mild recession, right, natural growth in this column, mild recession in the second row, that probability is 0.029, just kind of moving around the graph. And let's say if we're in severe recession, what's the transitional probability to maintain severe recession? That probability is 0.492. That corresponds with the number in the lower right. If we're in this current state, what is the probability we then transition? In other words, if we stay in severe recession, we have 0.492. As I mentioned before, there are a couple of zero probabilities to go from one extreme case to another. So if we're in severe recession, the probability of then going to a normal growth state is zero. There is no arrow from that node of severe recession to normal growth. So now that we have our stochastic matrix for this particular economic model, let's go ahead and use it in the context of a Markov chain to then make some predictions. All right, so let's go ahead and calculate a Markov chain for this example of economic forecasting. Again, recalling that here is our stochastic matrix P representing the various transitional probabilities. In the first computation here, I'm just going to be very optimistic in terms of where we start. So our x naught, our initial state vector, I'll make 1, 0, 0, where 1 corresponds with 100%. We're all in for normal growth, and 0, 0 for the sort of mild recession, severe recession types. So let's see if we start off with the best case scenario. What does this Markov chain predict for future economic outcomes? So remember then, by the Markov condition, as we called it, each subsequent state in our chain depends only on the previous state. And the way we transition from state to state is we multiply essentially by this transitional probability matrix, the matrix P. Let's go ahead and do that computation and find the prediction for sort of our probability vector for year one. All right, so then we'll multiply our initial state vector 1, 0, 0 by the stochastic matrix P on the left, and that will then give us our state vector for the following year. Let's just call it year 1. Notice, though, this calculation is quite trivial, right? I'm essentially doing a dot product when I multiply matrices together. I'm dotting each row with 1, 0, 0. So really, I just sort of pluck out or retain the first column for my stochastic matrix. How do we interpret then that state vector? Well, after our first year, the outlook is as follows. We have then a 97% chance of being in, once again, normal growth mode, and a 0.029% chance of being in a mild recession, 0% chance for a severe recession. And that's well and good, but I'd really like to, at this point, peer deeper into my crystal ball. In other words, I'd like to make a projection about a future outcome, let's say 10 to 20 years down the road, using this particular model. So the way I do that, of course, with the Markov chain is I iterate the process of matrix multiplication. So to get, let's say, state vector 2 after year 2, I once again multiply by p. But you'll notice with each subsequent computation, right, to sort of get the next state vector in my chain or sequence, I just multiply by p. So a nice shortcut is this. If I want to know, for instance, the kth state vector, that is my sort of economic outlook in this case after k years, all I do is exponentiate, in other words, take a power of my stochastic matrix, the kth power in particular, multiply it by the initial state vector, and then I get my prediction for the forecast for year k. And once again, we see a really nice application here of taking powers of a matrix. So now we can efficiently make predictions about future outcomes using this particular mathematical model. So for instance, what is the predicted status 10 years down the road? What is our sort of economic health and well-being going to look like? Well, I take my stochastic matrix, raise it simply to the 10th power, okay? Then I multiply by the initial state vector, 1, 0, 0 again, and that is the predicted outcome. So at that point, we've got 85% chance of transitioning then to normal growth, and notice creeping up here are the increased probabilities of the recessions respectively. And then one more time, if I want to then predict even further on down the road, 20 years, let's say, I raise my stochastic matrix to the 20th power, multiplying again by the initial state vector, and I get the following probabilistic outcomes. So if you're curious then, you might wonder, well, what if we had started with a different initial state vector, a different X naught, in other words? Again, this was a very optimistic outlook indeed. Can we be a little more cynical and see what then the model sort of conjures up for us? Well, sure. For instance, if I assume, and maybe it's a fair assumption, honestly, in this day and age, if I assume that maybe I have a uniform probability vector to begin with, in other words, all outcomes are equally likely as my initial state vector, so times are not so good economically, we'll say 1/3, 1/3, 1/3 for those components, then what happens when I turn the crank with the Markov chain and forecast 20 years down the road? In other words, I raise my stochastic matrix again to the 20th power, multiplying by this different initial state vector, and I get the following outcome, which is not drastically different, but you'll notice it's a little bit more dire indeed. Okay, so let's just kind of summarize our findings then between those two cases. So in one case, we had this initial state vector that was kind of representing our cheerily optimistic economic outlook, right? And we used our Markov chain to make a prediction 20 years down the road, what is sort of the state of affairs then? On the other hand, in the second case, we started with a vastly different initial state vector, a uniform probability vector. Once again, used our same Markov chain to make a prediction about the sort of outlook, once again, 20 years down the road. Now again, even though our initial vectors were quite different, the final state vectors predicted by the models in both cases were not entirely dissimilar. A good question to ask at this juncture is whether or not my Markov chain depends heavily on my initial state vector. So to what extent does tweaking that vector sort of change the outcome in the long run, we'll say, of our Markov chain? We're going to answer that question momentarily. And a closely related conceptual question, which is of ultimate importance for Markov chains, is to ask the following. If I project way into the future into my sequence of state vectors defined by this Markov chain, does that sequence ever settle down? Another way to put that in mathematical terms is, do my vectors converge to a particular value? If they do, by the way, that vector is called a steady state vector for the Markov chain, and it means that my dynamic process has converged to a particular value. In other words, it's settled down.